Hello, I'm Pietro Foti and I'm a PhD candidate at the Department of Mechanical and Industrial Engineering at the Norwegian University of Science and Technology. The work I'm going to present is part of a collaboration between the Department of Mechanical and Industrial Engineering of the Norwegian University of Science and Technology and the Department of Engineering of the University of Messina about the fatigue assessment of welded joints to local approaches. In the first section of this presentation, I'm going to show you the fatigue assessment of welded details through the Aerocode 3 and through the local approaches. Then I will show you the strain energy density method, the local approach considered in the present work, and after this we will see the parametric finite element model used to investigate the welded detail analyzed. Finally, we will go through the main results of this work and the conclusions that is possible to draw out. One of the aims of this work is to compare global and local approaches, highlighting the advantages and disadvantages of their use. The second aim of this work was to perform a parametric study on the common cruciform joint to assess the effect of its main geometrical parameters, together with the effect determined by complete penetration of the weldment, that, as we will see, it is not always required to ensure a failure from the weld tool. Dealing with the fatigue assessment of welded joints, the standards consider mostly global methods, like the nominal stress approach, even if the nature of fatigue phenomenon is local. The nominal stress method considers the nominal stresses in the critical cross-section and compares them with the SN curves that correlate the fatigue strength versus the number of cycles to failure. The standards define the so-called fat classes, which represent the fatigue strength at 2 million of cycles for the joints considered, and suggest for the Wöhler curves the same inverse slope in a bilogarithmic diagram for all the details. It is worth underlining that the classification of the details by the standard is not so satisfactory, having missing parameters even with very simple cases, and it results sometimes difficult to read, leading to possible misunderstanding. In order to extend their applicability to components with geometry that deviates from the one enlisted, the standards introduce some correction factors, such as the thickness correction or the misalignment correction. It is worth noting that also in these cases there is not a unique way to treat these aspects. As regards the thickness correction, for example, the standard proposes in some cases a correction factor to be assessed through an equation, and in other cases ranges of geometrical parameters. Anyway, the method discussed above is widely appreciated because of its simplicity and statistical proof, but it is important to notice that its validation is based on geometry and loading condition rarely found in real applications, that lacks in this way an actual statistical proof. As we can see from the image in this slide, the detail showed should be assessed as an attached plate. Anyway, the real loading condition is clearly very different and the determination of the nominal stress in this case is probably meaningless. According to what stated above, it is clear that the global approaches based on SN curves should be no more than a first guideline for dimensioning. The Eurocode 3 is dealing with the cruciform welded joint by considering the scale effect, establishing different fat classes constant in particular ranges of geometrical parameters. Regarding the possibility to have a different degree of penetration for the welding, the Eurocode 3 suggests a verification at both the weld toe and root. However, it is worth noting that such a verification must be done with two different fatigue curves. A parameter only partially considered by the standard is the welding height. Indeed, it is considered when assessing the fatigue strength at the weld root, considering that the net section to be considered change both with the welding height and the welding penetration. Deviation from the nominal design of the joint, such as the welding bead shape, are not possible to be considered, while deviation, such as the misalignment, can be considered through correction factors, but only within specific ranges. A more precise evaluation of the fatigue life of a component can be performed through the so-called local approaches, although they also neglect, like the global approaches, some welding peculiarities or deals with them in a statistical way. This is due to the fact that it is not possible to take into account every aspect that affects the fatigue life of a component. It would require a very high computational effort, leading probably to not appreciable differences in the assessed fatigue life. Each of these methods considers a local parameter whose critical value has the important advantage to be independent on the global geometry of the component considered. Anyway, also the local approaches have some limitations. First of all, they require certain expertise, considering that each method has its own theory and procedure to be applied. And second, they usually require the use of a finite element software, with, for some approaches, high computational time due to the very fine meshes required. Among all the local approaches, in this work we considered the strain energy density method. This method has been validated as a method to investigate both fracture in static condition and fatigue failure. The local parameter considered by this method is the strain energy density. The basic idea of the method is that the Brickshell fracture may be assumed to occur when the local strain energy density, averaged in a given control volume, reaches a critical value that is independent on the notch opening angle and independent on the loading conditions. This critical value could be evaluated for an ideal brittle material through the conventional ultimate tensile strength. This represents the basic idea of this method. Regarding the control volume, this is needed to evaluate the average value of the strain energy density. It has a characteristic length, R0, that is independent on the local geometry and on the loading conditions. It is assumed to be a material properties, and it can be evaluated through the mechanical properties of the material. The control volume shape, however, varies with the local geometry, while the control volume position is determined following the mode 1 dominance concept. Dealing with the welded joints, in order to use this method, some considerations should be done. Considering that the geometry of the weld bead cannot be precisely defined, some approximations should be done. In particular, the measurements on real weldments show that a real welding bead geometry in steel components is characterized by an opening angle of 135 degrees and a typical toe radius between 0.2 and 0.8 mm. That leads actually to approximate them to 135 degrees and to a sharp V notch in a finite element analysis to simplify the modeling of this detail. Speaking about fatigue assessment, the Heisegger fatigue failure happens in the linear elastic regime and shows a brittle nature. These two conditions allow the use of the strain energy density method to assess the fatigue strength of welded joints. In this case, the control volume characteristic length R0 can be assessed through the fatigue material properties of the background welded joints and of a notched component. This method has been validated with a huge number of fatigue strength data from steel welded joints with the fatigue failure both from the weld toe and root. As regards the practical application of this method for fatigue assessment, under the hypothesis of linear elastic behavior, it is enough to calculate through a finite element analysis the mean strain energy density at the weld toe root for a generic remote tensile load. Knowing the critical value of the strain energy density, intended as the value that leads the component to fail at 2 minutes of cycles, we can obtain the fatigue limit of the component in terms of nominal stress, using the equation reported in the present slide. For the purpose of this study, a finite element model has been created through ANSYS PDL software. The element used was a second order element, while the discretization in the model has been determined in order to have the control volume modeled both at the weld toe and root, in order to ensure an error as low as possible. Different numerical simulations have been performed with changing the main geometrical parameters described in the joint. The fatigue strength of the welded tail considered has been studied considering a control volume radius of 0.28 mm, and the critical value in strain energy density have been converted in equivalent fat classes according to the relationship of this method. The strain density method highlighted how the effect of the main plate thickness is overestimated by the Eurocode 3, that neglects instead other geometrical parameters that has been shown to have an aggregate effect on the fatigue strength of this component. The parametric finite element model has been used to investigate the effect of the welding penetration and to establish which, between the weld root and the weld toe, represent the most critical zone in the component. The procedure showed allowed the construction of the equipability surfaces with changing the main geometrical parameters in the components. It is worth noting how the strain energy density method allows to consider directly effects such as the interaction between the cracks of incomplete penetration. Making a comparison between the fat classes established from the Eurocode 3 and the ones predicted from the strain energy density method, it is possible to notice how the Eurocode 3 is significantly overestimating the influence of some geometrical parameters. Besides, the establishment of fat classes for ranges of geometrical parameters is obviously not suitable to describe the fatigue strength of a welded tail, resulting in a fatigue assessment that is quite approximative. In conclusion, the use of global approaches has been shown to have serious limitations even dealing with very common welded tails, whose fatigue assessment has been found quite approximative. The use of a local approach allows considering different geometrical parameters that can have an effect on the fatigue strength of a welded tail. By doing such kind of parametric investigations, it is possible to plan ad hoc experimental campaigns, reducing in this way the cost of this kind of investigations. Thank you for your kind attention.